What if I told you KyoAni made a series about Kanye West, 50 Cent, and Queen Latifah rescuing a rundown theme park from bankruptcy, complete with drunk mascots who say fuck, preschool gremlins, and Chris Tucker?
Amagi! Brilliant
Park! Kaimaku!
Welcome to Amagi Brilliant Park, where the only guarantee is fun. In the larger discussion of Kyoto Animation works, it seems Amagi tends to slip through the cracks. I foolishly assumed people didn't talk about it because there wasn't much to talk about. But if someone had pitched the series like this to me, I would have watched it years ago. So allow me to fill in as social media marketing manager for this disastrous theme park. Please keep your hands, arms, and legs in the cart at all times, kick back, and enjoy the ride. What makes a good theme park? If my childhood years of playing Roller Coaster Tycoon taught me anything, not this. Amagi Brilliant Park is a train wreck. You won't find any happy-go-lucky corporate mice amongst its cast members, replaced instead with a perverse pink thing and a puffy goat trying to meet his child support payments for the month. Half the rides are broken down, and the others have questionable entertainment value. Amagi essentially takes all the features of your typical amusement park and does the opposite. That is the show's main conceit and its major source of comedy, watching the circus act repeatedly fall on its face while flubbing their way into success just enough times to keep the show running. The jokes for each of its characters typically revolve around throwing their worst character trait back in their face, often literally. Amagi doesn't exactly do anything revolutionary for laughs. Rather, executes on a few fundamental principles of comedy exceptionally well through its odd punchlines and their delivery. That's right, it's time for everyone's favorite, explaining jokes.
Woohoo!
But let's talk about subverting expectations in comedy. You present the audience with a familiar image. They fill in the story in their heads before you twist it in a different direction. It's one of the most basic comedic ideas, but also pretty easy to fuck up. It's not funny simply because it's unexpected. That's how you fall down the so random rabbit hole. I think the joke works best when it ties back in to those initial expectations, satirizing the silliness inherent to that original image, making comment on the assumption of it, or maybe highlighting the absurdity of the subject at hand to go so far off course. Many of my favorite comedy anime use this as their primary driving force. The implementation of JRPG and classic video game elements in Magical Circle Gruder Gruder. The way Monthly Girls Nozaki-kun plays with rom-com, shoujo manga, and dating sim tropes. Or Konosuba with isekai, the last of which is most similar to Amagi and the way it toys with its characters' vices. Amagi constantly draws on this dissonance between the shiny picture of a fun thrill land we imagine and the theme park from hell we're given. Take the mascot characters, for instance. Everything about their personalities and dialogue contrasts their appearance and manner of speech. They look like the Fuafua friends you'd expect. Each of them ends every sentence with a catchphrase from their name, Mothel with Fumo, for example. And a few even make cute squishy sounds with every step. Meanwhile, Tiramisu's a womanizer, Mothel's overly aggressive, Triken's a perv, Macaron shouts mother puffer while bashing a seal. I could keep going. If these were normal human characters, they'd probably just annoy me. But the image of these mascots doing and saying these horrible things is inherently funny to me. The mechanics of the park itself use a similar discord. Even the previews play on this, as Sento ends each episode with a description of one of the park's rides, ranging from the demonstrably unfun to the most ridiculous concepts. My favorite is the Planet Earth ride, where Mr. Globe pleads with you for 10 minutes about how the planet is dying, and we need to act now before it's too late. A much starker reality than anything you'll find from Mr. Walt in Epcot. Amagi repeatedly employs the rule of threes, or the comic triple, a classic device in comedy. That is, posing three items with a pattern developing between them where the third usually breaks it. The idea is to build tension with the setup, but deliver the punchline before the audience catches on to that pattern. This formula is everywhere in Amagi. Entire episodes are structured through it, such as the Dungeon Crawler episode or the Elementario-focused Gauntlet episode. There it's more for narrative purposes, as each task builds their chemistry before the final test brings them all together. But the comic triple is baked in there too. Each task has its own punishment when they inevitably fail, going from the standard electrocution, to dropping a bucket of flour on their heads, to finally, literally threatening to kill them with a drill in some wacko saw trap. Here's where Amagi's use of the idea is a bit different. The first two elements in the set don't just set up the third, but serve as their own punchline, with each just getting increasingly absurd. Let's look at a few examples. In episode 6, Kanye holds a series of job interviews with the park short on help. Meanwhile, Sento, feeling the effects of a truth serum Macaron gave her, has a dream where three attractive young women get the job and attempt to replace her. When the One-sama type from her vision actually shows up at the interview, you know exactly where this is going. The other two will soon follow. But just when you think you're one step ahead of this show, that's when it hits you hardest. The first is a perfectly normal candidate, until she says she was an AV actress, which they take to mean adult video. Moffle spends the time casually trying to learn her stage name, Kanye panics like a teenage boy, and Sento tears into him, bangs her head on the table before she says too much, and finally takes control of the situation. Next, number two, the Genki go-getter type. Again, the interview starts well, before Kanye notices she has a fucking stab wound bleeding out all over the floor before her maniac brother charges in. They give her the job because, according to Sento, she still carried herself with dignity and her responsibility despite, you know, coughing up blood. Lastly, the high-pitched, stuttering lolly girl shows up, and after finally realizing her presence in the room, her big twist is nothing. They give her the job because she's actually normal, with Sento at this point resigned to her fate. Here, the stakes are all over the place. It gives you a setup you think you have figured out and just goes insane with it. Not waiting for the third moment to go up to 11, but actually bringing it back down. That, in itself, being the surprise. Other times, Amagi's use of the threes formula is a little less of a roller coaster. In episode 7, after a band of marine pirates invades the park, they force the park leaders to walk the plank. First, Tiramie, already having betrayed the group, promises Macaron he's a double agent and will get them out of this somehow, before betraying him again when he lets his guard down. Second, after witnessing Tiramie's constant backstabbing, Moffle pulls off an impressive maneuver to knock Tiramie over the edge instead, until we realize this was an extended sequence in his head, and he actually just slips and falls in practice. Third, Sento, overwhelmed with rage, will not fall victim to the same tricks, and intimidates Tiramie to the edge, reversing the situation. Each step here builds into the next. We see this again in the next episode too, but it's more of a comic quad than a triple. The main four fill in for Kanye at school, with each character's behavior leading to the next. Sento treats a girl with respect through a tough situation, causing her to question her feelings for another guy. The next day, Macaron confronts that dude and chases him off, making the girl fall for Kanye further, until Tiramie follows up on the third day, by taking advantage of her and showing his worst side. Finally, it all boils over on the final day, as Moffle is confronted by the girl's friends and the situation quickly explodes. I could keep going, but I don't want to blow all the series' best gags. Almost every episode dedicates a major joke to this idea. My point in going through all this is to illustrate how Amagi is built on these very fundamental principles in comedy, but executes them in such a tight manner, one joke flowing right into the next. It's indicative of a writer's room and directorial staff that knows exactly what they want to do, completely in sync with each other and their material. Beginning first and foremost with director Yasuhiro Takemoto. Perhaps the most incredible thing about Takemoto is the diversity of styles he could switch between and excel at. Amagi in 2014 was the first production he led since Hyoka in 2012, a slow burn character study. Look up and down the list of his works and you'll see the same story, from more high-octane comedies like Lucky Star and Full Metal Panic Fumofu, where they pulled Moffle from, to thoughtful drama and high speed, and even some in-between like Miss Kobayashi's Dragon Maid. An irreplaceable talent, to be sure, his style is all over Amagi Brilliant Park. Not just from a high level, but writing scripts for several episodes and directing others. Perhaps part of what makes Amagi work, and maybe the reason it's underwatched, is because it's so far outside KyoAni's normal range, something nobody at the studio would be better suited for than Takemoto. Much like the series plays on your expectations of theme parks, on a more meta level, you could even say it does the same with your preconceptions about what a KyoAni show is like. I came into Amagi with the headspace of what I normally expect from the studio, so when this cuddly mascot started talking about flicking the bean, I lost it with the dissonance there. Amagi Brilliant Park is KyoAni's hidden gem, not just because it's underrated or frequently passed over, but because it seems more like a play on KyoAni shows than one itself. A golden ticket to some chocolate factories may end in bitter disappointment, but this one promises just the opposite, surpassing my expectations considerably, and hopefully yours too. Don't take my word for it. Take Queen Latifah's, and come see for yourself on your next visit to Amagi Brilliant Park.